It's election season in the United States, and that means it's also political polling season. And so I'd like to start today by considering one of the great moments in political polling history. And by history, I mean the weeks leading up to the 2012 United States presidential election. In this great moment, television pundit and former politician Joe Scarborough said the following on MSNBC.
Nate Silver says this is a 73.6% chance that the president's going to win. Nobody in that campaign thinks they have a 73. They think they have a 50.1% chance of winning. It could go either way. And anybody that thinks that this race is anything but a toss-up right now is such an ideologue. They should be kept away from typewriters.
So it turns out he was wrong. But why was he wrong? Obama won re-election, but that alone doesn't make his assertion wrong. He didn't say Romney would win. He said it was a toss-up. He knew Obama could win. He just way underestimated the likelihood. But why? Could he have had ideological motivation? Well, maybe, but his mistake is also one that's easy for any of us to make. I would guess that his reaction was based on an availability heuristic. That's a word for using an idea that comes readily to mind as a shortcut in your thinking. Think about how people judge their risk of dying in a terrorist attack versus dying of a heart attack. Most people can draw more examples of terrorist attacks to mind. After all, they're covered in the news, and so they might rate them as more likely than they actually are. Most of the time, people use these shortcuts because they work, but we tend to pay more attention when they don't. Joe probably looked at recent polls, which were hovering near 49 to 50 at the time, and he probably knew there was some possibility of inaccuracy in polling. But most people also have readily available the idea of a coin, which has a 50-50 chance of showing one side or the other if you toss it. That looks really close to the kinds of polling numbers that people were seeing. So he thought this presidential race would probably behave like a fair coin. Now, it's a shortcut because it takes a number that correctly answers one question, but uses it to try to answer a slightly different question. It makes perfect sense that these are separate questions if one person polling at 80% and the other at 20. We wouldn't say the person in the lead has a 20% chance of losing. In fact, barring voter disinterest because it seems like so much of a sure thing, the chance of the first person winning is effectively 100%. After all, if we knew that the 2012 polls were 100% accurate at 50-49, then we'd know who would win. But these polls aren't 100% accurate. And when it's a tight race between two candidates, it's easy to look at polling numbers between, say, 48 and 52, and presume that those numbers can answer both questions. It's easy to say, hey, that's near 50-50. That sounds kind of like a coin toss. In fact, since I know this is just a poll and maybe the true level of support might be different, maybe it's exactly a coin toss. That's an availability heuristic, and it's probably how Joe Scarborough was thinking. It's a way of thinking we all use at some point or another. But, of course, he was wrong. To get the right answer to the second question, you have to look at another set of numbers that are included with most polls but not reported on as much. The margin of error, or confidence interval. That interval is a range surrounding the polling number that reflects how sure the polling firm is of that level of support. For example, a poll might reveal 40% support for a candidate with a margin of error of plus or minus 4, meaning they think the real level of support has a 95% chance of falling between 36 and 44. This ambiguity means that different polling firms can come up with different numbers reflecting the level of support a candidate has, without there being any change in that level of support in reality. Let's say, for example, that candidate Jane running for office actually has, in reality, 40% support in her state. But let's treat this as a secret that only we know as omniscient thought experimenters. So polling firm A runs a poll and reveals a 36% level of support, with a plus or minus 4 margin of error. So they know they could be off, but they're 95% sure they got the real level of support within 4 points. And we know that's right. So then polling firm B steps in a week later and gets it slightly off in the other direction. They report 44% with the same 4-point margin of error. We, again, omnisciently knowing that the true level of support is 40%, know that they did get the right number in their margin of error, so they're not entirely wrong. So in a week, two different polling firms revealed very different numbers based on the same level of support. Now, if nothing else happens, chances are the next polling company to run a poll will find a number somewhere in between the two. This is an effect called regression to the mean, and it's basically the principle that says if you find yourself with a really improbable result, chances are your next result will be much more probable. For example, if you roll an 11 on a pair of dice, you're much more likely to roll near a 7 the next time than to get another 11 or a 12. It seems straightforward, but what this means is you don't need to look for outside causes of the change. If you're at your job and you perform below average on your most recent TPS report, you'll probably return to somewhere near your average the next time. But if in between your boss comes over and chews you out for your poor performance, he might walk away thinking he caused the change, when it was actually just regression to the mean. So you'd should expect something closer to the true level of support if nothing else happens. But nothing else happening isn't what usually happens in the real world. What usually happens is that after polling firm B reports their results, everyone in the media reports that
support for Jane surging
and
Jane has the momentum.
And as we've covered previously on this channel, people will often choose to like and support what they already think is popular. This has been called the bandwagon effect, which is that the probability of an individual doing something goes up with their perception of how much they think others are already doing it. This effect has long-standing roots in classic social conformity experiments done by Solomon Asch, in which people would give observably incorrect answers about which line lengths matched if everyone else in the room was also giving the wrong answer. So what happens to candidate Jane? Well, most likely, after polling firm B reports 44% support, lots of people will read news stories about
Jane surging in the polls
and jump on the bandwagon, resulting in the self-fulfilling prophecy of an increase in actual support. And as you've probably seen, news organizations don't need to see a jump as big as 8 points to write that story. You can imagine that even, say, a 4-point jump could reveal the same reaction from the media, and the same effect in candidate Jane's actual level of support. So how can we avoid these effects, and perhaps try to be a little more like that omniscient observer? We can know with more certainty if we aggregate multiple polls. The more they seem to agree, the more certainty we have that they reflect the actual level of support. That still leaves some ambiguity, especially if polls are close, or if, you know, time passes and things change the way things always seem to. So to go from aggregate polling numbers to a percent chance of winning, take some slightly more complicated modeling. This is effectively the same sort of modeling that Nate Silver did in 2012 when he predicted a 73% chance of Obama winning re-election that Joe Scarborough mentions. Nate admits he's a liberal, so if that bothers you, you can visit a site like Real Clear Politics where they produce similar aggregate data. Most of the time, they agree on who's winning because they're relying on math and not ideology. If you need to put money down on who you think would win, I'd recommend relying on that kind of data. Or you could turn to people who are already putting money down on it. Lots of people believe that a better predictor is to turn to people who are looking at all the polls, reading all the news, and then putting their own money on the line in betting markets. This may be useful to have a human-level gut check in addition to the mathematical process of aggregating and weighing polls and running models. Most of the time, those predictions agree as well. At the very least, Nate Silver trusted his own math enough to put his money behind it. After that clip aired, he bet Joe a $1,000 donation to the American Red Cross that he was right. They canceled the bet and both made a donation.
So there's hope after all.
Thank you for watching. See you next time.